Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. It's my really distinct pleasure to talk to you today, and I hope I can live up to the responsibility of giving you some really useful information. And I compliment you for coming here and taking the initiative to listen and to think about these issues. I know that they're not easy. I hope to make some sense out of radiation risk, and I hope to give you some peace of mind as well. What does radiation risk mean? Well, you can use a variety of terms. You can say radiation risk is the likelihood. You can use the word probability. You can even say danger. You could say radiation risk is the danger associated with a specific amount of radiation exposure. I think of it in mathematical terms, probability. Now, the danger that I'm most concerned with in the line of work that I do is the risk of development of cancer. And as Norm Coleman explained, it's a process that takes many years, many, many years, even after radiation exposure. But radiation risk is similar in concept to other risks that you're already familiar with, that you're familiar with from everyday life. Now, of course, not all risky activities lead to cancer, but all are by definition potentially dangerous to your health. So I'm going to ask you to think about what are some other activities, or what are some activities that you're familiar with that are risky? How about traveling in an automobile? Is it risky? Well, it depends on how you do it, when you do it, how often you do it, and what way you do it. And we take it for granted that it's relatively safe and that's important to our livelihood, and in many ways it is, but it's not without risk. Mountain climbing, can be done with relatively low risk, can be done with relatively high risk, and many of you engage in this kind of activity as well as similar activities. Well, skydiving, you can do it with a trained expert who can guide you and will pull the cord for you, or you can be really brave and take on an extra risk as your choice. Now, I know that the conditions of this accident and these events are not of your choice, but I'm only giving these ideas so you can have a context about your own life, that it already has a number of risks embedded in it. How about cigarette smoking? Let me ask you a question. If I smoked one cigarette a month, would you say I was doing something risky? How about if I once smoked one every day? How about if I smoked a pack a day? So you see that it's kind of a continuum. It really depends on how you do it, how frequently you do it. What about radiation exposure? Is it risky? We accept radiation exposure as a very important part of our society. It has tremendous benefit in medicine. It also has tremendous benefit in providing the world with electrical power. And we also have conditions under which we have exposure that's not invited. I understand that. So I ask you, is automobile travel, mountain climbing, skydiving, cigarette smoking, radiation exposure, are these dangerous things? Well, you might say maybe they are, probably they are. But I would say the level of danger or risk for each activity depends on how you do the activity and how frequently you do it and how you do it. Radiation risk, like any kind of risk, like the cigarette smoking, it's not all or nothing. The risk of developing cancer increases with increasing exposure. People come to me all the time and say, Steve, what's the safe level? I can't give you that line in the sand, not from my position as a scientist. There's no distinct line in the sand that separates safe from unsafe. But, as Mike described, we have highly protective guidelines developed to protect the public, which have wide safety margins built in. And this is to prevent us from having to worry about these lines in the sand. We have margins built in through experts. So, question, can radiation exposure lead to developing cancer? I work for the National Cancer Institute. I have to say, yes, it can. But unfortunately, cancer is frequent among human beings, even without any radiation exposure. Now, how frequent? Cancer will develop in more than one-third of us in this room without any radiation, without any extra radiation exposure. Believe me, I wish I could change that. Cancer will claim about one-quarter of our lives without any extra radiation exposure. That means our risk is 25%. and that's 1 in 4. And Mike was talking about the protective actions are 1 in 4,400 that they've established for you. So our risk of just being alive and living as we do as human beings, we have a fairly high risk of cancer, fatal cancer. So does anyone really understand how dangerous it is? Well, the National Cancer Institute, a very prestigious and informed organization in Japan, the Radiation Effects Research Foundation in Hiroshima, and a few other organizations worldwide, we study persons exposed to radiation over many years. And the people we study are populations that include all walks of life, survivors of accidents, the A-bombs, people that are exposed as part of their job, medical radiation workers, patients, atomic energy workers, and others. So how do I study radiation risk? I want to give you this little bit of information so you'll know what it is that a person that has such an esoteric career as me actually does. We study populations for many years after the exposure, determine the number of cancers that occur in that group. It may be a large group, it may be 100,000, and we follow them for many years. And we have an expectation about how many cancers will occur in that group, because for all developed countries, there are cancer statistics available. So even before the study, we know about how many to expect. Now, if we find more than we expect, that's the excess number of cancers. And if assuming the population was exposed, we assume that that increment is due to the radiation exposure. And we determine how much increment of exposure increases the increment of the risk. Now, which study has been the most informative about radiation risk? Well, in a very sad and poignant turn of events, without a doubt, studies of the more than 120,000 survivors of the A-bomb detonations in Hiroshima and Nagasaki have been the population that has taught us most about radiation risk. Now, among those 120,000 survivors, over the years since the detonations, about 17,500 cancers have developed among that population. But after we account for the background incidence, that is the incidence of cancer that we know occurs in all populations, there has been, to date, about 850 excess cancers among the 17,500 that would have occurred anyway. This is where we have learned. Were cancers more frequent among those that were more highly exposed? Well, of course they were. But in the group that was exposed to less than 100 millisievert, the fraction that would be attributed to radiation was less than 2%. Now, these units I know are unfamiliar to you, but what did Mike tell you but that the background radiation was 6 millisievert or even less? So if the fraction in those with 100 millisievert was less than 2%, then for those of us that get the normal 6 millisievert, the radiation is not a detriment of any real significance. So are the data from such radiation risk studies relevant to me and my family, or to you and your family? Well, they are. I've already explained to you that the baseline cancer rate for death is about 25%. And I can use the results of these studies to quantify what extra risk you might be receiving from any exposure that you received in Tokyo from airborne emissions. To the best of my knowledge, from consulting with the other experts that are attendant from the United States and in Japan, the exposure is something like less than 10 millirem to residents of Tokyo. So added onto that 25% is a indistinguishable from zero small increment. It's very tiny. And I know that with a fair degree of confidence from all the studies we've conducted over the years. Let me say that again. The likely increase in radiation-related fatal cancer risk in Tokyo, given the present dose information, is so close to zero that it's indistinguishable for me as a scientist. I hope that's of some peace of mind to you. Now, what can you conclude about the risk of radiation exposure? Well, I can only offer you my personal opinion, but there are some facts here as well. Cancer risk from radiation is a continuum. It's not all or nothing. It's not a line in the sand. The more exposure, the more risk. At the same time, the public is generally well protected by the guidelines established by authoritative organizations who have studied these issues, and exceptions to those guidelines that might be necessary under what might be called unusual conditions or emergency conditions, those do not normally create any excessive danger for the simple fact that they have this tremendous safety margin built in. So my advice to you, and it's advice I take as well, each of us needs to promote a lifestyle that reduces our overall risk. You don't need to be focused, as things stand now, on radiation risk. Radiation is only one component of your overall daily risk, and more often than not, it's a minor component. And with that, thank you for your attention.